Hi, welcome to the Hurricane Utah Adult Religion Class, sponsored by the Hurricane Utah North Stake of the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints. I'm Mike Parker, and since 2008, it's been my privilege to be the instructor for this class. The Hurricane Utah Adult Religion Class meets on Thursday evenings between September and May to discuss the scriptures, teachings, and history of the restored Church of Jesus Christ. If you live in or are visiting the Hurricane St. George area, I'd love to have you join us. Time and location are available on the class website. There's a link to that in the show notes just below this video. Also on the class website, you can download my notes, which includes footnotes documenting my sources, this PowerPoint presentation, and handouts that I distribute in class. Please note that this YouTube channel and the class website are not official sites of The Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints, the Hurricane Utah North Stake, or any other church unit or department. I alone am responsible for the content on these sites. What you're about to see is a recording of my notes for one of the lessons. If you enjoy this video, please click the like button and share it with a friend. And please feel free to subscribe if you'd like to be notified when new content is posted to this channel. My friends, the gospel of Jesus Christ is true. Joseph Smith was a prophet of God, and the authority and keys that he held are now vested in the First Presidency and Quorum of the 12 Apostles of the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints. And most importantly, Jesus Christ is the Son of God and the Savior of the world. I hope you enjoy this lesson. In this lesson, I'll introduce this course on the Doctrine and Covenants. I'll also discuss how Joseph Smith's revelations and other material were compiled, edited, and published, and how this became the volume of scripture we have today. This lesson will include selections from Section 1, the Lord's Inspired Preface to the Doctrine and Covenants. The schedule for this course will take a mixed chronological topical approach. For example, in Lesson 11, we'll cover Section 29, which was written in 1830, Sections 43, 45, and 133, written in 1831, and Section 116, which was written in 1838. I combined these sections into a single lesson because they all address the subject of the second coming of Jesus Christ. Likewise, in Lesson 18, we'll cover Section 84, Section 107, and Official Declaration 2, all of which deal with the authority and offices of the priesthood. To benefit from this course, you'll need a copy of the standard works of The Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints. The section headings in the 2013 edition of the Doctrine and Covenants are more accurate than in previous editions. If your copy was printed before then, you don't need to buy a new one. Just be aware that some information has been updated. If you're using the church's Gospel Library app for mobile devices, then you have the latest edition. I also highly recommend that you make use of the material from the Joseph Smith Papers published by the Church History Department. The goal of the Joseph Smith Papers Project has been to gather and publish all existing documents written by or under the direction of Joseph Smith. These documents include journals, revelations and translations, histories, correspondence, administrative records, and legal and business records. The Joseph Smith Papers have been published as 27 printed volumes. The contents of the printed volumes, plus additional material, is or will be made available online at josephsmithpapers.org. These documents are vitally important resources for understanding the context of Joseph Smith's revelations and how they were recorded, edited, and published. Another resource I recommend is the Church History section of the Gospel Library, available online and in the Church's Gospel Library app for smartphones, tablets, and PCs. In it, you'll find all the published volumes of Saints, the Church's new four-volume history,
Revelations in Context, and Joseph Smith's Revelations, a Doctrine and Covenants Study Companion, which give thorough backgrounds on how, why, and under what circumstances the revelations in the Doctrine and Covenants were received, along with other helpful resources in written, audio, and video formats. The Joseph Smith Papers and Gospel Library Resources replace the 7-volume History of the Church, Teachings of the Prophet Joseph Smith, and other older historical publications that are now outdated. Just to clarify, you don't need to purchase anything to benefit from this course. Most of the resources I'll refer to are available free on the internet. Ultimately, the goal of every class in the Restored Church should be to bring us to Christ. In this class, we're going to do this by examining the Lord's commandments and promises in the Doctrine and Covenants. The Hurricane, Utah adult religion class is different than other classes you typically encounter in the church. Most church classes focus on practical application of gospel principles, using the scriptures only to the extent that they illustrate those principles. In this course, we're going to focus instead on understanding the text of the scriptures. We're going to examine the Doctrine and Covenants from several aspects, including the history and context of the revelations. This will help us understand when, how, and why they were given. The meaning and development of the text, including how the revelations were received, compiled, and published, and what effects these had on the emerging church. Their influence on and importance to the early saints, what the early saints did with the revelations and how the revelations impacted church history. And most significantly, their influence on and importance to us today. What do the revelations published in the Doctrine and Covenants mean to us and to today's church? As I just mentioned, this course is different than what you'd normally expect from a gospel doctrine class or even an institute course. We're not going to avoid or gloss over challenging questions and uncomfortable topics. In fact, we're going to confront them head on. This course will be faithful to the leaders of the Restored Church, where they have spoken definitively, unanimously, and by revelation, their teachings constitute the doctrine of the church. At the same time, Elder D. Todd Christofferson taught, it should be remembered that not every statement made by a church leader, past or present, necessarily constitutes doctrine. Individual leaders have disagreed about matters that haven't been clearly established by revelation. In some cases, an opinion held by an influential church leader may be widely believed by members of the church, but that does not make it doctrine. Where the doctrine of the church has not been clearly and conclusively established on a subject, we'll examine different faithful interpretations. I feel it's important to state explicitly that I am not infallible. If you have questions or concerns about anything I say, please get in touch with me. There's a contact form on the class website. You'll find it linked in the menu on the left side of each page. If anyone watching this is not a Latter-day Saint, I'd like to extend a special welcome to you and tell you how grateful I am that you've taken the time to watch this video. In this course, we use Latter-day Saint scriptures, the Bible, the Book of Mormon, the Doctrine and Covenants, and the Pearl of Great Price. We believe these four books are equal in authority and are complementary companions. What makes the Doctrine and Covenants different than other scriptures? The introduction to the church published edition of the Doctrine and Covenants explains, quote, "The Doctrine and Covenants is unique because it is not a translation of an ancient document, but is of modern origin and was given of God through his chosen prophets for the restoration of his holy work and the establishment of the kingdom of God on the earth in these days." Unquote. The Doctrine and Covenants is a question and answer book. Most of the revelations in it came from specific questions that the prophet Joseph Smith and his associates brought to the Lord. It contains unique doctrines not revealed in any other book of Scripture, including the 3 degrees of glory and understanding that nearly all men and women will receive some degree of glory. Proxy ordinances on behalf of the dead who did not hear the gospel during mortality. The new and everlasting covenant. The sealing of husbands and wives for eternity. The eternal nature of intelligence, spirit, and matter. The authority, powers, and responsibilities of those who hold the priesthood of God. The organization and functions of the church. The word of wisdom. And tithing. And the law of consecration. The Doctrine and Covenants is evidence of the prophetic calling of Joseph Smith and his successors. From the introduction, quote, "These sacred revelations were received in answer to prayer in times of need and came out of real life situations involving real people. The prophet and his associates sought for divine guidance, and these revelations certify that they received it." Unquote. Joseph's revelations provided divine direction for the unfolding of the restoration of the gospel. They addressed issues critical to their time, including the voice of warning and the importance of spreading the gospel, the ongoing revelation of priesthood ordinances, offices, and keys as the church grew and expanded, the establishment of Zion and the organization and administration of the church, a fuller understanding of key doctrines, such as the nature of the Godhead and the plan of salvation, and the witness of the Lord Jesus Christ, his divinity, his majesty, his perfection, his love, and his redeeming power. The Doctrine and Covenants is the closest thing we have to a revealed handbook for administering the church. It established the foundation for other revelations and policies that have been revealed since the time of Joseph Smith. Church President Harold B. Lee taught, quote, "If anyone, regardless of his position in the church, were to advance a doctrine that is not substantiated by the standard church works, meaning the Bible, the Book of Mormon, the Doctrine and Covenants, and the Pearl of Great Price, you may know that his statement is merely his private opinion. The only one authorized to bring forth any new doctrine is the president of the church, who, when he does, will declare it as revelation from God, and it will be so accepted by the Council of the Twelve and sustained by the body of the church. And if any man speak a doctrine which contradicts what is in the standard church works, you may know by that same token that it is false, and you are not bound to accept it as truth." Unquote. Most of the revelations published in the Doctrine and Covenants were received by the prophet Joseph Smith during the formative years of the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints. They were received as the main body of the church moved from New York to Ohio and Missouri, then to Illinois, and finally to the Intermountain West. Nearly one-third of the revelations in the Doctrine and Covenants were received early on in New York and Pennsylvania, and nearly half were received in Ohio. Those early years of 1829 to 1833 were a rich revelatory period for the prophet. They established the framework for everything that has followed down to our own day. The Doctrine and Covenants is a foundational book meant to establish the organization of the church and the important doctrines necessary for the restoration. On the day that the church was organized, Joseph Smith received a revelation commanding that there shall be a record kept among you. This established a divine mandate to keep a written history of the church. In obedience to this commandment, Joseph and his associates spent much time and effort attempting to publish his revelations. Joseph did not commit to paper every revelation he received, nor are all of his written revelations published in the Doctrine and Covenants. The canonized revelations are the ones that are binding upon the church and used to measure and control the teachings of its members. Joseph most often dictated his revelations to scribes. The example you see here is the earliest surviving manuscript of what is now Section 21, the revelation received on the day the church was organized, commanding Joseph to keep a record. It was transcribed in 1831 by John Whitmer into the Book of Commandments and Revelations. These manuscripts were highly prized by the early members of the church. Orson Pratt recalled that some members took their own handwritten copies of the manuscripts and circulated them among their acquaintances and local branches of the church. Errors in these copies proved to be a problem when they were used as the sources for early publications of Joseph Smith's revelations in newspapers, periodicals, and pamphlets. This is the first page of the first issue of the monthly newspaper, The Evening and the Morning Star, published in June 1832 at Independence, Missouri. In this issue, the Articles and Covenants of the Church of Christ, now section 20 of the Doctrine and Covenants, became the first revelation officially published by the church. In November 1831, Joseph Smith called a special conference at Kirtland, Ohio, to consider publishing the revelations. During the conference, he received a revelation that is now included in the Doctrine and Covenants as section 1. Verse 6 proclaims, quote, "Behold, this is mine authority, and the authority of my servants, and my preface unto the book of my commandments, which I have given them to publish unto you, O inhabitants of the earth." Unquote. Based on the wording in this revelation, the planned volume of Scripture was called a Book of Commandments for the Government of the Church of Christ. For over a year and a half, Joseph reviewed and corrected manuscripts in Kirtland and sent them to Independence, Missouri for printing. In July 1833, however, a mob destroyed the printing office, its printing press, most of the manuscripts, and many printed pages that were intended for the Book of Commandments. Several Latter-day Saints managed to rescue some of the galley sheets and bind them into makeshift books. About 100 unfinished copies of the Book of Commandments were preserved. The one pictured here was owned by Wilford Woodruff. In September 1834, the Kirtland High Council organized a committee to make another attempt at publishing the revelations. Joseph Smith was authorized to review the manuscripts and make corrections and changes as he saw fit. We'll discuss that in a moment. This effort resulted in the first edition of the Doctrine and Covenants, published in August 1835 at Kirtland, Ohio. The one pictured here was owned by Elizabeth Ann Whitney, wife of Bishop Newell K. Whitney. In the earliest editions of the Doctrine and Covenants, the lectures on faith preceded Joseph's printed revelations. These seven lessons on theology and doctrine were prepared for the School of the Elders in Kirtland. Their stated purpose was to unfold to the understanding the doctrine of Jesus Christ. They contain lengthy instructions and scripture references on faith, miracles, sacrifice, and the character and attributes of God. We don't know who wrote the lectures on faith, but the evidence points to Sidney Rigdon as the primary author. Regardless of who wrote them, Joseph Smith approved them and prepared them for publication in the Doctrine and Covenants. Many statements in the lectures on faith are familiar to Latter-day Saints. For example, Lecture 6, verse 7, quote, "Let us here observe that a religion that does not require the sacrifice of all things never has power sufficient to produce the faith necessary unto life and salvation." Unquote. Initially, the lectures on faith were the doctrine, and the revelations were the covenants and commandments, hence the title of the book, Doctrine and Covenants. The lectures on faith were included in the Doctrine and Covenants up until the publication of the 1921 edition, when they were removed. The introduction to the current 2013 edition explains that, quote, "Although the lectures are profitable for doctrine and instruction, they were not given or presented as revelations to the whole church." Unquote. As I mentioned a moment ago, at the November 1831 conference where the revelation now called Section 1 was received, Joseph Smith was given permission to correct any errors found in the revelations, as directed by the Spirit. Verse 24 of the revelation proclaims, quote, "Behold, I am God, and have spoken it. These commandments are of me, and were given unto my servants in their weakness, after the manner of their language, that they might come to understanding." Unquote. The language of the revelations is not perfect in some absolute, unchanging, and eternal sense. God works through fallible mortals who express the impressions of the Holy Spirit in imprecise and imperfect human languages. This is a significant point because some Latter-day Saints mistakenly assume that God gives revelations to his prophets similar to how an executive dictates a letter to a secretary. They believe that the Word of God is God's words and that the prophet simply writes down what God says. This is not the case, however. The nature of revelation can be expressed in the following four principles. Principle 1. God speaks to individuals according to their capacity to understand. Joseph Smith taught, quote, "If Jesus comes to a little child, he will adapt himself to the language and capacity of a little child." Unquote. President Brigham Young declared, quote, "I do not even believe that there is a single revelation among the many God has given to the church that is perfect in its fullness. The revelations of God contain correct doctrine and principle, so far as they go, but it is impossible for the poor, weak, low, groveling, sinful inhabitants of the earth to receive a revelation from the Almighty in all its perfections. He has to speak to us in a manner to meet the extent of our capacities. If an angel should come into this congregation or visit any individual of it and use the language he uses in heaven, what would we be benefited? Not any, because we could not understand a word he said. When angels come to visit mortals, they have to condescend to and assume, more or less, the condition of mortals. They have to descend to our capacities in order to communicate with us." Unquote. Principle 2. Revelation usually comes to prophets just as it comes to other Latter-day Saints, through the impressions of the Holy Spirit. President Wilford Woodruff explained, quote, "Now with regard to revelation, what is revelation? It is the inspiration of the Holy Ghost to man. Joseph Smith said to Brother John Taylor in his day, 'Brother Taylor, you watch the impression of the Spirit of God. You watch the whisperings of that Spirit to you. You carry them out in your life, and it will become a principle of revelation in you, and you will know and understand this Spirit and power.' This is the key, the foundation stone of all revelation. Joseph Smith was full of revelation. He could translate anything given to him of God. He could receive revelation without the Urim and Thummim. Many of the principal revelations contained in the Doctrine and Covenants were received without the use of the Urim and Thummim. They were given to him by the inspiration of Almighty God." Unquote. Joseph Smith taught, quote, "A person may profit by noticing the first intimation of the Spirit of revelation. For instance, when you feel pure intelligence flowing unto you, it may give you sudden strokes of ideas, that by noticing it you may find it fulfilled the same day or soon. That is to say, those things that were presented unto your minds by the Spirit of God will come to pass, and thus, by learning the Spirit of God and understanding it, you may grow unto the principle of revelation until you become perfect in Christ Jesus." Unquote. Principle 3. The inspiration comes from God, but the choice of words is up to the prophet. Elder B.H. Roberts wrote, quote, "Where the Almighty uses a man as an instrument, the manner in which that revelation is imparted to men may receive a certain human coloring from the prophet through whom it comes. We know this to be true because the message delivered to Israel through Jeremiah differs in style of phraseology from that delivered by Isaiah, Amos, or Ezekiel. The inspiration of the Lord need not destroy the personality of the man through whom it is made. The grammar may be the prophet's. The idea, the truth, is God's. Unquote. Principle 4. Because the words are the prophet's, the prophet has both the right and the obligation to change the wording of a revelation if he receives further light and knowledge, feels that he could have expressed it himself better, or for any other reason. B.H. Roberts explained, quote, "Some of the early revelations first published in the Book of Commandments in 1833 were revised by the prophet himself in the way of correcting errors made by the scribes and publishers, and some additional clauses were inserted to throw increased light upon the subjects treated in the revelations, and paragraphs added to make the principles or instructions apply to officers not in the church at the time some of the earlier revelations were given." Unquote. Joseph Smith taught in the spring of 1843, quote, "God may correct the scripture by me if he chooses." Unquote. With those four principles in mind, let's look at some examples of the types of changes that Joseph Smith and others made to his early revelations. Grammar was corrected. In Book of Commandments 24:46, the adjective "this" could lead to the misunderstanding that there is more than one Church of Christ, so it was logical for Joseph to clarify the intended meaning by replacing "this Church of Christ" with "the Church of Christ." Elder Orson Pratt, a member of the Quorum of the Twelve, acting under the direction of President Brigham Young, fixed a common grammatical mistake in Book of Commandments 9:12. The verb "was" follows the singular subject, faith, not the plural, prayers, which is part of a phrase. Their faith in their prayers was. Grammatical corrections account for the majority of the editing that took place between the 1833 Book of Commandments and the 1835 Doctrine and Covenants and in its later editions. Surnames were added. These were personal revelations given by Joseph Smith to his close associates. In the earliest manuscript versions, individuals were referred to by their first names only. When the time came for publication of the revelations to a wider audience, Joseph added their last names so readers would know who was being addressed. This is just one example from what is now Section 52 of the Doctrine and Covenants. Words and phrases were added. Joseph Smith's revision to Book of Commandments 24:35 added the important controlling principle that meetings, while being led by the Spirit, should also follow the format set forth in the revelations. Our worship services are not a play-it-by-ear free-for-all. The Lord's house is a house of order and not a house of confusion. In another instance, Joseph's revision clarified and expanded on the original by explaining that "him" referred to the only living and true God. In Book of Commandments 4:2, the meaning of "pretend," to profess, to claim, is now obsolete in English. Joseph Smith didn't feign or fake the ability to translate. He affirmed and asserted that he had that gift. And of course, he did have it. Another problem with the original wording is that it could be misinterpreted to mean that God would give Joseph Smith only the gift to translate, and Joseph would receive no other spiritual gift than that, ever. The revised version clarifies the passage so that we understand the gift to translate was the only gift Joseph received at that time. But once he was done translating, God would give him other spiritual gifts. Words and phrases were deleted. These are two examples of Joseph Smith removing extraneous phrases that were unnecessary to the understanding of the passage. This is one of a handful of passages that the prophet removed completely for the 1835 edition of the Doctrine and Covenants. He didn't say why he excised this portion of what is now section 42. Perhaps he felt that the material had been superseded by a later revelation or simply no longer applied. Organizational terms were updated. When what is now section 42 was received in early February 1831, the office of high priest had not yet been revealed. Joseph retroactively added it to this passage when he revised the revelation for publication in 1835. When the church was established in April 1830, it was led by two elders, Joseph Smith and Oliver Cowdery. In November 1831, the presiding elders of the church became, by revelation, the First Presidency. Since the First Presidency had authority over the presiding bishop, the revelation was updated. Revelation was reassigned to a different individual. Joseph Smith ordained Jesse Gauss and Sidney Rigdon to be his counselors in the presidency of the high priesthood on 8th of March, 1832. Later that year, Jesse Gauss was excommunicated from the church and replaced in the presidency by Frederick G. Williams. The instructions given to Gauss regarding being a counselor to Joseph Smith were transferred to Williams, so the wording of the printed revelation was altered accordingly. A few changes have left some puzzling historical questions that scholars have been unable to answer. Here is one of the most interesting examples. The meanings of both the original wording in the Book of Commandments and the revised wording in the Doctrine and Covenants are not clear. There is no record that Oliver Cowdery or anyone else living at that time had difficulty understanding what this passage referred to, but its meaning has been lost to us. The phrases "working with the rod" and "hold it in your hands" seem to indicate that Oliver Cowdery's gift was something tangible, perhaps a staff or a divining rod. Divination of water and treasure were common practices on the American frontier in the early 19th century. Unfortunately, we will probably never know in this lifetime what this passage means. To summarize, revelation is a dynamic process involving the Holy Spirit and the best efforts of the prophet to express the message of the revelation in his own limited language. Some revelations in the Doctrine and Covenants were edited by Joseph Smith to improve the accuracy of the words and the clarity of the message. This was both his right and his obligation as the prophet who received the revelations. This partly explains the Lord's counsel in section 1, verse 38. Quote, "What I the Lord have spoken, I have spoken, and I excuse not myself. And though the heavens and the earth pass away, my word shall not pass away, but shall all be fulfilled, whether by mine own voice or by the voice of my servants, it is the same." Unquote. Whether the Lord speaks directly through a personal visitation, or speaks through the mouths or the pens of his prophets, it makes no difference. That voice is the word of God, whether it is Joseph Smith's words, or Russell M. Nielsen's words, or the words of an angel, or the Lord's own voice. Including the Book of Commandments, there have been 10 major editions of the Doctrine and Covenants. The current edition was published by the Church in 2013. It's an update to the 1981 edition, which included 3 new canonized revelations, along with new and better footnotes and section headings. I strongly encourage you to use the 2013 edition of the Doctrine and Covenants. If your edition was published before 2013, it's incomplete and inaccurate. If you're using the Church's Gospel Library app for mobile devices, you're reading the 2013 edition. I'd like to conclude this lesson by sharing the testimonies of 3 leaders of the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints about the Doctrine and Covenants. The first is from President Ezra Taft Benson, speaking as president of the Church. Quote, "The Book of Mormon brings men to Christ. The Doctrine and Covenants brings men to Christ's kingdom, even the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints, the only true and living church upon the face of the whole earth. I know that. The Book of Mormon is the keystone of our religion, and the Doctrine and Covenants is the capstone with continuing latter-day revelation. The Lord has placed his stamp of approval on both the keystone and the capstone." Elder Spencer W. Kimball, then a member of the Quorum of the Twelve, testified, quote, "Since the first vision in 1820, additional scripture has continued to come, and numerous pertinent and vital revelations have been flowing in a never-failing stream from God to his prophets on the earth. These scriptures are called the Doctrine and Covenants. We declare them to be divine and official and authentic communications from the Lord to men through divinely appointed prophets, and that there never has been and never shall be an end to the prophets so long as men have faith and believe and live righteously." Unquote. Elder J. Golden Kimball, who was a member of the First Council of the 70, witnessed, quote, "My dear brethren and sisters, what is your objective? That question has been put to me more than once. Our objective is to carry out the will of God and through the direction of his servants, the prophets, to fulfill every prophecy and every revelation that we find written in the Doctrine and Covenants. For surely God will not forsake his people if they will repent of their sins. It is needless for me to say more." Unquote. That concludes this lesson. If you enjoyed it, please click the thumbs up button and leave a comment below. Please subscribe if you'd like to be notified when new lessons are posted to this channel, and visit www.huarc.org to download these notes and this slideshow. In the next lesson, we'll discuss Joseph's first vision, the visitations of the angel Moroni, and Joseph's reception of the gold plates of the Book of Mormon. The reading is Joseph Smith history in the Pearl of Great Price. Although technically that isn't part of the Doctrine and Covenants, it's an important prologue to our study of Joseph Smith's revelations. See you next week.